I'm not going to say this.
I won't try.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We are going to be having a lot of business tonight, so I would like to ask anyone that wants to talk to go outside. Do not talk inside this room unless you're up at the podium. We're going to start with appointments. Ellen Lavin, to the front, please. How you doing? I didn't see you there.
We have time for calling the meeting to order.
I am great. Thank you. I'm here tonight to get approval to borrow $4 million on a line of credit from Provident Bank at 2.5%. What we usually do is I come in with a note and you all sign it, and Ronell, who is bond counsel, has asked that we come to get approval first, just in case there's a question.
Okay.
And then we'll be back next week with the note and all the paperwork that goes with it.
I'll be happy to so move, Mr. Chairman.
Please.
I got no problem with it. It's fine. You can go ahead.
Okay. Mrs. Wolseley?
I move to approve.
Mr. Bean?
I have no comment.
Mr. Wardell?
Could you just maybe explain for the public so they know what you're talking about? Because they say you borrowed $4 million for
vacation. Until taxes come in.
Yeah, we know that. Just so public is aware.
A tax anticipation note is I borrow or I don't borrow. I have a line of credit, or I will be having a line of credit with Provident Bank in case we need money. I usually do this every year. Last year we approved, or you approved, $4 million. Mm-hmm. We did not borrow. So it's there in case we need it, but I do not borrow unless we do. So. And the reason we do go to Provident is Citizens and TD want you to borrow the whole dollar amount up front.
Yeah.
And I don't like that. So we borrow as we need.
Yeah. This is the this isn't the first time that...
No, I know that.
Yeah. Right.
Just so that people...
That's fine.
Oh, I got a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor, unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ellen.
Nice to see you.
Nice to see you.
And we are going to move the consent agenda. Number one is a new elderly exemption application to be denied. Mm-hmm. Number two is a new disabled exemption application. Number three is a new elderly exemption applications. There's a number of them. Number four is a new veterans tax credit application. Number five is requalification of a disabled tax exemption. Number six is requalification of blind exemptions. There's a number of them. Number seven is the 2015 sewer abatement rate. Number eight is the elderly tax deferral application. Number nine is the 17 F Street termination of lease of Fred Curley. Number 10 is the 17th Street new land lease. Number 11 is the entertainment licenses for the Boardwalk, the Victoria Inn. Number 12 is a raffle permit fundraiser for Adina Beaudry.
Also move the consent agenda.
I'll have a second, but I have a one slight correction.
Okay.
On number four, it says Pierce 68 Lock Road. It's actually 84 Lock Road.
Right.
So
typo.
Mm-hmm. It's a typo. I want to make that correction.
Yep.
Other than that, I'll move it.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Now we're going to have the public hearing for the North Beach neighborhood issues. Just so that people know, we're going to have the hearing for the other end of the beach is going to be next week. I believe I'm right in this, Mr. Welch, that we've had over 600 emails.
No, we had 600 notices we issued.
600 notices we sent out, but right. How many were the
You have...
This is the complete response, what we have?
Yes.
Okay. And of the 600, people that were on private streets were not notified, and we're looking for...
On the beach, anyone living on a private street was not notified because we have no jurisdiction there. None at all. The town has no jurisdiction on private roads. And people at the mobile home park were not notified because they have private roads also. So we have no jurisdiction inside that fence line at all, except for the police and fire department.
And we're looking forward to hearing from everybody. Everybody will be able to talk. We're asking that you keep your comments to 2 minutes or less. So who would like to join us up here?
Yeah, because it's denied.
Please join us. Excuse me one second. I wanted to ask one more thing from here from the board. Do we want to listen to everyone, or do we want to, on occasion, ask some questions?
Up to you.
I'm fine with questions.
I'm fine with questions. When everybody comes up, please give your name and address.
Right.
So that we can make sure that we get that clear and concise on the report. But if we have questions, I think we...
Okay, so after the person speaks, I will ask if there are any questions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Chairman Griffin, Mr. Welch, members of the board, my name is Jack Saldi. I reside with my wife at number 312 Street here in Hampton. We do have a concern about the parking on 12th Street. It seems to be like the gateway to the beach for the surfers. Reason being 12th Street is one of the most popular ones is because the cut to the beach, the stairway is at the top of the even streets. But I think 12th Street probably takes the majority of the surface up there. I would welcome to have you put up resident parking only signs on our street. And the reason being, we have a lot of out-of-staters. We have numerous guys from Quebec that kind of overtake the place, and non-residents that park there. They have no respect for your property. They park there, they throw their boards on your lawn, they leave their trash there, and, you know, I get up early in the morning, I put my truck out in front of my house just to protect my property. My wife and I take a lot of pride in keeping our property looking nice, and I don't like it having destroyed by incoming people. Now, at the end of 12th Street, they have marked off the end of the street near King's Highway in yellow paint and says no parking so many feet to the corner. And I always thought that there was a law that said you cannot park within 20 feet of a corner of a road. Now, you don't do that on the other end of the street, which is Ocean Boulevard. So we have cars parking on the corners of Ocean Boulevard and 12th, and they park quite often on both sides of the street. It's so narrow there, and it's dangerous. You can't even get out of there when you want. So I'd like to pose a question, if I could. Is that true that that is a law that says you cannot park 20 feet from a corner?
It is.
It is.
It is.
The chief is back there saying yes.
Yep. All right. Not to pick on the police because I don't want to get arrested, but
we'll see.
The police drive by there 100 times a day, and they never tag any cars on the corner unless you call in a complaint. So I don't understand why they don't. And my other point is, if you decide to put up signs and everybody gets their signs that says resident parking only, if you're not going to assure us that the streets are going to be patrolled and monitored, there's no sense in even having this meeting.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We're at 2 minutes.
All right. Thank you very much for your time.
Did anyone have any questions that they wanted
Well, do we want to answer his question?
No, I don't think so. I think if you want to ask any questions of what they've said, the chief already answered about the parking.
Well, but he wants to say something. I'd rather hear him.
Well, I think we need to clarify a few issues. The 20-foot setback from the corners at an intersection road is a town ordinance portion of our traffic regulations. Now, when you go down to Kings Highway, that's a town road. 12th Street is a town road. When we intersect with the state road, that's governed by DOT and what signage they put up and what they're willing to accept. Now, they're very open to accepting what the town would want. As you know, we have those 10-minute parking signs up there. Those are at the town's request. If we want to enforce that 20-foot setback, it has to be posted and marked. And what you get for objections to that are, how many more signs do you want out in front of your property? So if you want the 20-foot setback off the corner, DOT is going to want to put a sign up right in your front yard again. So be careful what you ask for. You just might get it, because if we ask them, they'll put the signs up. I spoke with the district assistant engineer today, but before we can write tickets, we have to clearly delineate the areas you can and cannot park.
So that would be on every corner?
That should be, if we're going to do one corner, we should do them all.
Yep. Right.
So if that whole, and I agree, that is a difficult area to try to get out from. Mm-hmm. As you try to come up onto Ocean Boulevard and you're trying to cross a lane of traffic, you really have to be careful because of the way the cars are parked. Now, if you go down to the main beach, you'll notice some of the streets, we've put those signs up. No parking here to corner. And we've put down the yellow paint on the pavement. But you have to properly post that so people know not to park in proximity to that corner to keep the sight lines open. I would be very happy if we could accomplish that. That would be great. Kings Highway is less of a concern because as you turn onto Kings Highway, the east side of Kings Highway is already posted no parking. So it's less of a problem unless somebody's already illegally parked.
The only question I have for you, Chief, is if we did do a resident parking only, the only way we would have to be able to enforce that is by having our town parking stickers, correct?
Similar to Seabrook Beach. And when you register your car in Seabrook, you get the resident sticker like you do here if you want it. And that's the only way you can park on Seabrook Beach is if you have a resident sticker. And I just want to be very clear. I'm not for or against that. That's more of a political decision. My primary concern here is the safety issues of where they're parked. And the biggest issue I have is getting up and down those numbered streets with the parking on both sides. You cannot get a fire. If you have cars parked in the same area on both sides of the road, sometimes you can't get a cruiser up and down the road.
I understand that. So, We got to have some sort of way of being able to tell how that vehicle is a residential thing, and the only way we have right now to do that is the parking sticker that you get that the town issues when you register your car.
Well, it's similar how we enforce the municipal parking lots. I would envision if we went that route, that's how we would enforce.
And these are things that we're going to talk about, and we're going to deliberate, and we're going to be able to ask him these questions. This meeting here tonight is mostly for the people that are here.
Well, I just want the people in the audience to realize that.
Okay. Someone else like to join us at the podium?
Good evening, everyone. Frank DePippo, Dumas Ave, up in Boar's Head. And what we see is a problem in the neighborhood, or I see in the neighborhood. They park anywhere they can because if they walk down the street, they're at the beach. They don't want to, I can't think for them, but my guess is that they don't want to pay the state $2 an hour. So if you could please at least go to, starting off with the resident sticker, to identify cars, at least the people in town, when they pick up their sticker, if the police department wanted to give them some type of information, it could say, you have this sticker. You can only park in these areas. Please observe the following. You at least then have a subset of people who are from town, who are residents, and you'd probably get a little more compliance where people come into our neighborhood, they block the mailboxes, they block people's driveway. They block, even though they're not blocking your driveway, they park across the street where you try to back out, where it's not accessible as far as it's not wide enough. if fire apparatus came up the streets, whether it's Sunsurf or some of these other areas where they're parking, they've discovered the neighborhood, and they've discovered that if you walk down the street, you're at the beach, and you don't have to pay. And they'll do that at any time. And when the officers come up, and they'll come up on a call, they say, I'm sorry, the area isn't signed for this, as the chief was saying. We can't do anything right now because the only sign up here says no parking this side or anything else. It doesn't say, you know, don't block mailboxes or resident parking only. So if you could consider doing something with the problem, I think it'd be appreciated. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We appreciate it.
I have a quick question for Frank, may I ask?
Yes.
Are you talking about something, Frank, like signage saying violators will be towed?
Whatever the department and, you know, the selectmen decide works, but that is part of it. If you know that you're going to get, say, a $10 ticket, I could just tell you from enforcement days, you know, when we would write tickets back in national parks and stuff. If somebody knows that the parking costs $20 and the ticket's $10, they'll take the ticket.
Read and everything. That we're not going to really discuss that tonight.
Right.
But we got your what you're saying, because you know, we'll be deliberating on this in the future. But thank you very much.
And maybe the money from the tickets could go to police and fire overtime.
It's all decided already.
Had that meeting before.
Someone please join us at the podium.
Come on, everybody's complaining, guys. Now come up and talk.
Good evening. Rich and Rosemary Poria. We're at 897 Ocean Boulevard. We're on the south corner of 18th and Ocean. And that crosswalk that abuts our property that goes to the beach is just so dangerous. So, and for one reason, from the corner to Ocean Boulevard, you know, if there's two cars parked on that lot, that car that's abutting Ocean Boulevard is actually just about in the crosswalk. And people coming off the beach have to go around that car into the middle of 18th Street. It's really a tough thing. And I guess it's a state road, like you mentioned earlier. But
that's a little bit different. It's the proximity to the crosswalk. I believe you can't be within 10 feet of a crosswalk. But
right,
again, but what the state doesn't do compared to, like, when you drive uptown on Route 1, when you see our crosswalks, there's usually an area marked out that clearly delineates right where you can and can't park in proximity. The state doesn't tend to do that down at the beach.
Yeah, it's just a real dangerous crosswalk. I've been hit with my chair coming through there, just with cars coming through. And if they could put, you know, that little foam thing in the middle that says crosswalk or something in the middle of the road, just to slow people down, it would be helpful.
They have been very resistant to that.
I know they
I would love to see them also, but the state DOT has been very resistant. You've seen them out there in the past. Those were privately owned. People put them out there. And
okay, because I was wondering about that.
Yeah, that wasn't the state DOT that put them out there in the past.
Just to let you know, it's almost impossible to get a crosswalk. A lot of people want them, and we have very little. Those are controlled by the state completely. We have very little control over
right
them.
But I was just saying at the end on 18th, if we could, like, paint the corner again, just so if you have two cars there, by default, that car closest to Ocean Boulevard is going to be in that crosswalk. And people just jam it in there real tight. And it's tough coming off the beach that way. So,
did you have any other comments?
No, that was it. Just that 18th is one of the busiest traffic roads. And, again, everything's so tight up there. But from all the folks in the back neighborhood, it's an automatic walkway. So when you have that car, when that street's fully loaded with cars, it's tough to have people walking up and down it to get to the beach as well. So it's pretty dangerous out there when it's packed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We appreciate it. Somebody else like to join us at the podium?
My name's Paul Coward. I live at 813 Ocean Boulevard. One of the problems I like to see in, the cars are parked along the side of my house. I know it's a street. I don't have a problem with that. But they take the boards off. They lay them on my lawn. I have to go out and tell them, please don't do that because the salt kills my grass.
Yeah.
And another question I like to ask, why can't they just stripe the 25 feet from the highway to the side street? They'll get the message. Give them a couple of tickets. That'll stop it. And the next problem is the kids out in front of my house at night. It's not 8, 9 o'clock at night. It's 1, 2 o'clock in the morning. They're out there with their radios blaring. We call the police. I don't blame the police. They come up in my car. They're not halfway down the street. Up it goes again. And we don't see the police the rest of the night. I don't want to keep calling the police because I feel guilty. But something's got to be done. I can't open my windows at night. When I watch TV, my windows are closed. That's all I have to say.
Thank you very much for your comments. Who, please, someone else join us?
The name is Jeff Goff, 71 Kings Highway. And I realize about the parking situation. And that the difficult part about that is on the side streets, when they park on both sides of the streets, the opportunity for an emergency vehicle to get through is out of the question. Just bringing that up. And the other thing is the town or city of Hampton could make $1,000 a day if they had somebody patrolling Kings Highway. The speed that goes through there is just too much for the amount of children and people that want to and have recreation in the area. Also, between 6th and 7th Street last summer, there was a white van that people lived in next to somebody else's house. They were in there for the summer. And I think that, and I'm not talking a camper, I'm talking a white van that was just a van, and people were living in it, and nothing was done about that. And that was between 6th and 7th Street.
Did you make any complaint for that?
Near Kings Highway. My wife did, yes.
So, and she sent a signed complaint?
No, verbal.
Just so that people know, you need to send a signed complaint before anything will be acted on. It's pretty much how the town operates, I believe. Do you want to mention to them about how we make money off tickets?
As far as...
A lot of people seem to think that's how it works.
The town wouldn't make money on the tickets because the money does not go to the town of Hampton. Motor vehicle violations, those funds go, and it's divvied up in different places. It helps run the court system. It helps run the police academy. But we don't get money from motor vehicle summonses. We get them from town ordinance violations. Your point being is they're driving too fast on Kings Highway. I absolutely agree with you. I spend quite a bit of time on Kings Highway myself. I have friends down there. I frequent your coffee shop down there. And I've seen it, and I do stop cars down there myself, and I do see my guys down there. And I appreciate the feeling that, oh, we never see a police officer. If I stop down there on a Sunday morning at 9 o'clock, I'll see the police go by at least 4 or 5 times in an hour. But I'm paying attention to that probably more than most because I'm waiting to see what my folks are doing related to speeding and particularly parking in that area. So they're down there, maybe not as much as you'd like to see, but I also have limitations on what I have for resources.
But we need some sort of an incentive for you folks to be rewarded for stopping and finding.
I'll have to disagree with you on that. You should never allow your police department to be designed to generate revenue. That would breed corruption, and it's we write tickets to address issues. We don't do it to make revenue, and I'll have to disagree with you on that one. The reward is we work in a great town, and we got a great police department, and we're proud to serve you folks, but that's the reward. It has nothing, it can never be tied into the fines.
Yeah, people don't seem to realize that. Now, Mr. Welch, am I correct in saying that,
sir,
they need to sign the letter and send it to the proper...
You can send it to my office, so they can send it to
place.
The building department. If it comes to my office, I'm going to go to the police department. I'm going to go to the building department. I'm going to go to whatever department's involved. Even if it's anonymous, if the complaint looks to be viable, we'll at least investigate it to see whether something's going on.
In your office,
we don't want somebody hurt because we didn't investigate a complaint.
And if you sign it, something will definitely be done. You can rest assured of that.
Okay.
Thank you.
And the department is?
Just under the town manager's office.
Yeah.
We'll make sure it gets done.
It stops at the, you know, Mr. Welch is always does a good job That particular comment could have gone to the building inspector also. But if you send your comments to Mr. Welch, he'll take care of you. That's why he gets the big box.
I don't know how other residents feel about Kings Highway, but I think the lighting is a little on the sparse side. But I don't know how others feel about it.
Thank you. That down. Who would like to speak next?
Oh, good.
How are you doing? My name is John Panette, and I own multiple properties on Ocean Boulevard. I guess
where at
851-847. The corner of 13th Street where we had the accident with Mrs. Weinhold and so forth. To kind of wrap up the people that have actually spoken so far, I have not had any issues with surfers or whatnot parking on the lawn or any of that kind of stuff. I think that I would like the issues to be addressed regarding probably speeding on Ocean Boulevard. That's probably the biggest thing. And I actually do have a couple friends that do work for the state that have been kind of staking out in front of the house occasionally for speeders. That's probably the first thing. Second thing is probably the noise, and perhaps doing maybe a noise ordinance or something after 9 or 10 o'clock at night.
Have a noise ordinance.
It can get pretty after. And I understand that a lot of people like to hang down at the beach. I think we were all very young at one point in time, but it seems like over the last 4 or 5 years, people have become a little bit more obnoxious, and it actually gets pretty bad. With putting down the windows and still being able to hear people with their radios is actually not exaggerating. You know, that actually does happen where you're in bed and you have to call the police at like 10 o'clock at night to have someone quiet down. I guess the only other thing is I'm very against signs. I would like to see that if we can enforce parking, to have something maybe painted on the roads. I know. I just think the telephone poles and signs look trashy. I mean, I just...
Unfortunately, with that's not a... under current law, you have to have a sign that's posted so many inches up before it's valid. Just painting it on the ground does not make it a valid sign. It's hard to enforce.
So along Kings Highway, where we have the painted no parking on the corner, are there signs... With the yellow
on the length of Kings Highway, I think if you'll notice, if you're driving northbound,
right,
on that east side, it's pretty consistently posted no parking.
Okay, well, I mean, I guess my point is that people that are parking along the numbered streets, they do block driveways, they do block mailboxes, and that can be kind of a, especially if you're going to have guests over or someone that's staying at your house and you don't have anywhere for people to park in your driveway, it can be kind of a, and I can assure you that the tax rate for some of these houses along Ocean Boulevard, is fairly high, and to be able to use our driveways and get our mail is kind of would be nice sometimes, especially during the warmer days. So
I think you're complaining about the not being able to use your driveway.
Yeah, just the driveway and the
cars in front of your house.
Right. I mean, I think to kind of target surfers or Canadians or that, I mean, I've owned these properties for multiple years and I have not had specific problems with a certain group of people. It's I think it's avoiding the payment that you have to pay to park on Ocean Boulevard, and that's why people are actually parking on these side streets. So
Now, Chief, how do you address his problem with listening to people's radios? They do not violate the town noise ordinance, I don't believe.
Well, the noise ordinance, there is a portion about the sound of music coming from a vehicle. If it can be heard outside of the vehicle, technically it is a violation of our noise ordinance.
What if they're playing a radio on sitting on the wall?
That becomes a whole different ball of wax.
So I'm just pointing these things out just so that people understand.
Yeah, I mean, summertime, you think of, like, your screen doors. Harleys, you think of like, you know, people enjoying the summertime and loud radios, but I think, you know, if you're in bed or you have to go to school the next day or something, it's a week. I mean, this is not just on the weekends. This is
trust me, this is something that comes many, many times. You know, all those houses all along Ocean Boulevard opposite the wall have been complaining for years about the people on the wall.
Yeah.
There's really not always something we can do about that particular noise.
Yep.
I have a question. You have rental property, so,
mm-hmm.
So if there was permit parking only, resident permit parking, how would that affect your rental property?
Well, I actually have set back, so my property line actually goes out into the street where it's actually paved.
Good.
So anyone that's actually staying in any of these homes, they know that they need to be, you know, parked in.
So you have off-street parking.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think 847 can like park. I think like 8 cars or 9, and then 851 is like 4.
Then you get into a problem though of what is a driveway, and that's part of that's been down the problem down there too. Mm-hmm. Is
well, I was told that prior to me actually purchasing the properties, I think that 851 actually had a brick wall or something that went out too far for the plows, so we were told to either plant grass there or pave it, and I think the Brewitt family decided to.
That comes into the whole issue of right of ways on even the town streets and the state highway. Is when you go down there and other sections of town, you can see where people have built out into the right of way, where it makes it very difficult for a plow to go down the road or for people to normally park where they should be able to park.
I just don't want to see more signs. I think signs just kind of, you know, and maybe one solution. Is that maybe the town could issue cones or something, temporary cones that could be put down so people aren't parking there.
Probably not going to happen. I don't think, but we'll take it into consideration. It's hard to do things that are temporary like that.
Yeah, I just have a question. Is there anybody with an opposite point of view? Is there anybody that has the guths to come up here? Anybody who thinks it's too that they don't want to see the parking become too restrictive? You know, I'm just opening it up, if there's anybody that
we
has...
We have a problem with people having the permits, even. You know, the people try to get multiple permits, and that has been a problem in the past, right, Mr. Welch?
It has.
So something like that's impacting, you know, like a cones or whatever.
Well, I can assure you that if I took the property lines out on both houses, mm-hmm. and I had grass there, then, you know, I wouldn't be able to obviously have anyone park there, but people that were going to be parking on the sides of those properties, you'd probably not even be able to get one car through, you know, if they were to actually park there. Mm-hmm. So,
well, thank you very much. Right. We appreciate
much.
It. Who would like to speak next? Mr. Patello.
I'm Ralph Patello. Perhaps you've heard of me. I live in Hampton here, and I just wanted to point out, talking about this, you guys that have a problem with the surfers. I'm a surfer. I've been surfing for 50 years now. And there is a way to get the word out. I write a weekly blog. Dave Cropper, who owns Cinnamon Rainbows, has a website that's lots of surfers. A lot of those guys from up north in Quebec, they read our blogs. They read the websites. I think we can get all the surf shops together and put up something on our websites that you can't park here, you can't do this, you can't be, you know, throwing surfboards on someone's lawn. We can get that word out. We can do that as surfers. We can, you know, we kind of police our own out in the, no offense, we police our own out in the water anyways.
I'm not going in after you. Not doing it.
We do police our own in the water.
Water's cold in August.
So we could get the word out for that, you know.
Good.
I know what you're talking about because I've seen it myself. So I'm down there all the time, you know, taking photos, so we can get the word out on our end. So just to, you know.
That's great.
You have a question?
Yeah, please.
If there was only the metered parking, Ralph,
yeah.
Is there enough metered parking if you have a lot of surfers and stuff in town? You know, is there enough parking there?
Well, you know the summer, what the summers are like. I mean, we're all scrambling looking for a spot, you know. So maybe you knock down a few of those houses on Ocean Boulevard and make a parking lot.
Generally, the surfers are there first thing in the morning, so they have a pretty good shot at most of the parking.
Some of those surfers have jobs. That was my 2 minutes.
Thank you. We appreciate it, Ralph. Who would like to speak next?
Mr. Chairman, for the record, my name is Sheila Francoeur. I live at 88 Kings Highway, and I have lived there for 35 years. And I have seen it all.
Yes.
The good, the bad, and the ugly. But mostly the good. You know, I know everyone has a legitimate gripe and a complaint. And certainly I've had my share. But when you really sit back and think about it, when are the biggest problems? They're on that very hot Sunday afternoon in the summer when it's probably 95 degrees and everyone is trying to get out of Manchester and Lowell and Lawrence and every place else and get down to the beach. Is it bad then? Yes. I'm sure the chief has trouble getting a car down Kings Highway on some of those Sundays. I know I have trouble getting out of my driveway. Because as one resident said, one of my pet complaints is the SUV that parks on Kings Highway right at the end of my driveway so that it's impossible for me to see going out. I'm going out blind. I'm going out very carefully. And I'm praying that that speeder that someone else has seen on Kings Highway is not coming down the road at that time. How often does that happen? I can probably count it. Maybe on both hands during the summertime. Mm. It's an inconvenience. Would I like to see it resolved? Yes. My other gripe is the individual car that comes down, parks in front of my property, and leaves the car there for 4 or 5 days.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. Now, I make the assumption that that individual is renting someplace. And the person who is renting the property has an overflow of parking. We all know what happens at the beach. You rent a place, it has two parking spaces, one for the two cars in your family, and then all the relatives come down. And they all have cars, and they need someplace to park. Same thing with the trailer park. It's an overflow. How often does that happen? Maybe 2 or 3 times this summer season. Do I like it? No, I don't. Is it tolerable? Well, in the larger scheme of things, yes, it is. I've lived all over this country, and I can tell you, we chose to live at Hampton Beach. It's a wonderful place to live. I've lived there when we moved down in the wintertime. We thought we were going to be isolated. And we fairly were at that time. Now it's become a year-round neighborhood, and it's a wonderful neighborhood. My opinion is the North Beach is the jewel of the beach. And really, I hope the press doesn't put too much in about all the good things up there, because we don't want it being crowded. We like it the way it is. Now, certainly over the years, I've been known to maybe have a slightly short temper, and I thought, oh, maybe we do need resident parking up here. But, you know, this isn't the Cape. This is Hampton Beach. And people love to come and share the beach that we all are very fortunate to be able to have access to. Now, I would caution you, first of all, I want to thank you for having this, because I think it's really important to have all these people out and have the opportunity to have their say. Yeah. I think that is vitally important. And I can tell you, I haven't seen half of these people before. I didn't know they were my neighbors. But I would caution you that whatever you do, you know, be very careful of that terrible phrase, unintended consequences, because you may think that you're solving a problem in one particular area. But unless you do it very carefully, you will create a problem in another area. So I would caution you about that. I think the key to this issue, and the most important part, is the safety. We do have to know that the emergency vehicles can get through. Yeah. Would I like to see more police cars on Kings Highway? Well, I have to give the chief credit. I have seen more police cars on Kings Highway lately. As a matter of fact, I got kind of concerned I've seen so many. Is there something I should know about that's happening on the street?
That's where I have my coffee.
I know that. You already told me that before.
And the residents, when they see me walking in uniform and the cars are parked, so I tell the gentlemen, get down there and the ladies get down there in the morning and clean it out, because it becomes a problem because they start parking on the wrong side of the road. So it's just been one of those things, and I've received a number of complaints from folks towards the Winnicott Road end of the speeders. It's becoming like a jet port, people taking off. And so we're trying to get down there and just be visible, because most of the people that we find speeding are actually residents. So we're trying to manage that fairly and let people know we're there.
Mm-hmm. I also have to give some credit to Ralph Fratello. You know, certainly people that know may know, we do have kind of a large piece of land that on Kings Highway. So we have a lot of cars that park down. And it's not unusual for the surface. Early in the morning, I can tell. I look out and say, oh, it must be good surfing, because I know who the vehicles are. They come back. Okay, so they get dressed in my front yard. I guess I've gotten used to that. For the most part, they're very courteous. They don't leave anything behind. I know they're going to be gone as soon as the tide changes, and I don't have a problem with that. Have we had issues in the past? One or two, but not too many. I've actually been on my deck, and I've had a surfer come up and thank me for letting him park in front of my house. I've had that happen more than once. The other group that I always interested in, and this is, I think, is really important. I've sat there and I've seen the grandmother come down or the mother come down, two little kids, the cooler, the beach chairs, and head up to the beach for an afternoon of fun on Hampton Beach. Same thing. They come back, pick up all the stuff, and they leave. So I would caution you about resident parking. I'm almost there, but I'm not there yet. Because, you know, first of all, I think you'll find it difficult to enforce. And the first thing that residents will have an issue with is, I have guests, where are they going to park? So that always becomes an issue. So as I said before, thank you very much for having this. I think it's very important, but be very careful of what you do, because every action has a reaction. Thank you all very much.
I'd like to thank Mrs. Francoeur. For anyone here that doesn't know it, she served the citizens of New Hampshire for 10 years as as a state rep, and she was, what, the majority?
I was there.
And that's why she speaks so well. So we thank you. Thank you very much. At this point, I'd like Mr. Welch to talk about what the boundaries of the state park in Hampton is.
Now, Mr. Chairman, and I think everybody realizes what the state owns, the so-called state park, which runs from the bridge over Hampton Harbor all the way to Boar's Head on the south side. And then it picks up again on the north side and runs from there to High Street. That's all state park, the beach portion. And Dredd, which operates that, also operates the sidewalks in front on that side. The remainder of Route 1A belongs to the Department of Transportation, which is a state highway agency, traffic control agency, and so forth, all the way over to the front property lines on the west side of the street. So those are the two state agencies we deal with on a regular basis. We this past year, we had state DOT, the Transportation Department, enact an ordinance dealing with 10-minute parking from High Street to, I believe it was Church Street, and they'll be doing the remainder out to where High Street, where Ocean Boulevard merges back to Ashworth Avenue this coming year as we give them the new information. So we do have a relationship with them. We do work with them all the time. The problems that we get cited were in your letter are the problems that we encounter every single year with problems with individuals. Not all the people that come there are problems, but some of them are, and some of them have obviously been aggravating some mm-hmm. folks who live over on the opposite side of Ocean Boulevard and all the way down to the Kings Highway. So we wanted you folks to come in and tell us what your problems are so that we can think of a solution, perhaps, to those problems.
And at this point, I'm going to read one of the letters that has come in. This one, I thought it really was, it pretty explains, I think, the way many of the letters are. This is from Greg Grady. That's the New Hampshire Sandcastles. He's worked on this, you know, doing the sandcastles. So he's used to doing some stuff down here at the beach. So who hit may concern? I have lived at 120 Kings Highway for over 16 years and believe I have a pretty open mind as far as the beach usage and how important public access is for the economy of the town and state, as it is my own as well. That being said, the conditions and episodes I have witnessed during the time have continually gotten worse to the point has become disgusting and very troublesome in many ways. In my observation, three groups are using these areas. One-third are family. Readers, he sees mostly New Hampshire license plates. One-third are Canadian, and one-third are surfer-oriented. He lives, by the way, next to where that pump station is. His bullets are, families generally are fine, but always have trouble finding a spot and park haphazardly, cleaning up after themselves and using bathrooms, probably of the houses they're visiting. Canadians are using a free parking spot, bringing food, camping, leave litter, and defecate anywhere. Surfer-oriented groups that utilize the free parking aspect are out of control with lewdness, public defecation, and littering. This is compounded by Canadians who are surfers as well, and groups of non-residents that are directed to park here to park, who normally would not have and now are aware it is for future use by surf instructors for free parking. I believe a park bypass method should be established for local town and New Hampshire residents. The spots parking would be used as a group that in the past has proven to be more respectful, pays taxes for the upkeep, and is indeed for the use. Unfortunately, signage enforcement is very expensive and most likely a ways out, so a minimum of an increased enforcement and presence would at least deter this situation. So that's, you know, one letter, and I thought I'd just read that. Mrs. Wolseley?
If I may, I'd like to ask a generic question of the audience, because what you just read and what Mrs. Franker said cover an area that I have a huge amount of complaints on, and that's messing up people's yards, dumping trash in your yard, performing personal functions in your yards. Can I just have a show of hands? How many of you have a lot of trouble with that in the summertime, with messes left in your yards?
Well,
okay.
It basically blows from across the street.
Because I get a lot of complaints, especially at North Beach, from people saying that, you know, people dump the baby diapers on their lawn and all the messes and all that stuff.
It doesn't look like we had any people that raised their hand. Okay. With Mr. Waddell?
Yeah, I would just like to say that, you know, I know, I don't know if they want to speak or not, but there were some business owners in the audience.
That's what I was going to ask.
And how that affects a business owner.
Good.
So, what do you, Dave?
The parking, Robert, Dave or John, my favorite sandwich shop's back there, he's hiding.
I'd be happy to speak and address any questions. And one thing, I love our community. I graduated Winnicott in 86. I started working at the surf shop when I was 15. I took it over in 1989, where Nelson's Candy was. And in 2000, we moved to the front of the building. Love our community and very proud of our surf community. However, here it doesn't feel good to hear that we are, at least I can speak for myself, that's not, surfers leaving trash and leaving your boards on your yard is definitely not something we want and something we would like to, like Ralph said, police ourselves. So I can sympathize with you. I certainly wouldn't want that on my yard. I don't know where else
well,
we can.
If it was all resident parking, would that affect you at all from a business point
of
view?
Well, I will say, that's a good point. It's more or less the parking lots for us. The parking lots around us were changed 2 years ago, and we lost about 30 places to resident parking. For us, those parking lots, we can't we work around it. I actually have people employees park at my house on weekends. We carpool. We ride our bikes. We don't want to use those lots. I have 8 people working on a sunny weekend in July, and there's just not enough spots. So we try to be respectful and do whatever we can for the parking lots. But we can't afford the parking lots to go more resident than it is right now. If that makes sense.
Mr. Welch, was it 3 years ago that we did that? Or was it 2 years ago?
We put the signs back up 3 years ago.
Yeah. At one point, there was a problem with somebody removing the signs. So we don't know where that happened. I'm sure it wasn't from your store.
Nothing, yeah, no.
But it was all the time.
He has not. Dave has parking over to the north side of his store, and then there's those other parking lot that's opposite.
Sure.
On High Street there. And those, for people that aren't aware of it, we have made a new policy 3 years ago, and we've been trying to be fair to all of the, you know, the people that live in Hampton, the people that want to come to those restaurants. And do you have more comment on that?
Well, from being on the beach over the years, I just want to say that the parking and the traffic, it really comes down to Memorial Day, Labor Day, 4th of July, and sunny weekends in July and August. There can be days during the week in July and August, midweek, where parking isn't really that much of a problem. But sometimes you get the perfect storm. You get big waves, you get a holiday weekend, and sometimes the weather just lines up, and that's when you're going to have the problems. And I don't think there's really much you can do to the parking to alleviate that. I think it's the same thing if you leave Boston at 4 o'clock.
Yeah.
There's nothing you can, you know, you're in rush hour. And I think we're always going to have parts, have times of the year where there's just going to be more people. It's going to be tough to find a spot. There's going to be a lot of people everywhere. But what I wanted to reiterate is what Ralph said is we have a voice and a message, and I'm more than happy to, if you can decide on something that'll work to help get that message out. Like I said, I don't want a few bad people giving us as surfers who are invested in our community a black eye.
And what about, how often is your store open? When is your store not open? I mean, as far as the
year-round? We're open every day year-round. A lot of snow days this year. But we're only closed 4 days a year. And we employ up to 40, we employ almost up to 40 people in the summer.
And that's not counting all the people that make those bathing suits.
Yeah. And I love the community, and I'm always going to be available.
He's got a great store.
And I'm always available to address any issues. We've always worked closely with Jim Donahue and the lifeguards and the police. And if there's issues, I feel like that's what they're there for. And I think this is great because it all starts with communication. So, and everyone, I think, needs to be on the same page. So I commend everybody for showing up. And if there's anything I can do to help, I'm happy to.
Why don't we have the man from the secret spot come up also, since he's good talking about the same location?
Sure. I'm John Gazzo. I have the secret spot. I'm in the same building as Dave. I've been there for about 9 years now. And I was involved with you guys as far as addressing the parking issue the previous year, because
yes,
we had taken out Kings Highway. We got that back, which is awesome. Mr. Waldell, just to answer your question, if there was resident parking all of Kings Highway and all the number streets, that would absolutely affect my business. No question about it. Having High Street be a free-for-all, basically, as long as it's under control, certainly allows maybe 30 to 50 more cars park, access the beach and access my business and everyone else on the corner. So to answer your question, yeah, that would definitely affect my business very much. I thought what we did for the parking lot by High Street and Kings Highway, it was great for everybody. There's resident parking, there's non-resident parking, there's scooter parking, there's everyone can access it, and there's also resident parking, two other lots that that residents can.
Do people use the scooter parking?
Absolutely. I know a lot of my employees do because they can't find parking when they come in at 2 o'clock on that sunny surfing Saturday. So yeah, they absolutely do. I noticed motorcycles do park there too, and they get tickets and they come in and complain, but you know, it is, they don't read the signs.
And your store is open, what, 8 months of the year?
Not even. It's May to October.
Yeah.
So, yeah, we're seasonal. So, I have 5 months to really make a buck, and you know, every parking spot counts for me.
Well, we appreciate that you came here tonight. I went Absolutely. To your store to get your opinion, and I noticed that you weren't open quite
yet.
So thanks for
not
coming
yet.
In
Thank
here
you.
Tonight.
Thank
we
you.
Appreciate it.
Mr. Chairman, may I just, for the record, Mr. Favreau, who was a leaseholder in that same building as the prior two speakers, would like the status quo to remain in force, and any changes to parking, as the two gentlemen before that spoke, would have a very negative impact on his business. Thank you.
Thank you. I went to speak with him also. We're going to... the lady behind, the one that's standing up. Yeah, we'll come back to second time around before it's over. Everyone's going to get to talk, and we want to hear from everybody.
My name is Joyce Kern. I live on Dumas Ave. And I just want to say, you know, it's not that the businesses could buy some spaces if they paid the taxes that we have to up on Dumas Avenue. So far, we have people, and it is the surfers. And the surfers do come up. They take all the spaces in front of your yard. They'll come into the, your yard and use it to look at the I'm just looking at the waves. Well, you know, then pay my taxes and live up here.
Let me just let you know that everybody pays taxes, and whether they pay taxes or not, they're entitled to the same rights. And it
oh, they're entitled to my backyard?
No.
Oh, right, they're
you
not.
You need to call the police when something like that happens.
And I have, and if they're not doing anything, I called them one time, and because they had a beer, they're sitting on the side of my street, but because they weren't, they were on private property, my property, but it was private property, they couldn't do anything about the guy drinking on my front yard.
And he was in drink someone? Okay, you want to address that, Chief?
The open container of alcohol was on private property. Our ordinance says that you cannot have an open container of alcohol upon a public any public way. So her backyard is not a public way.
So someone's allowed to sit and drink in her yard?
No, I didn't say that. Okay. I said the alcohol. Let's break this down into the components. Okay. I know people are getting upset here and maybe not getting the clear picture. If somebody walks onto your property and they don't have your permission, and it's not posted, you ask them to leave. If they don't leave, you call the police. When we arrive, if they don't leave upon that request, we can arrest them for criminal trespass.
Yeah.
The alcohol issue, our town ordinance says you cannot consume alcohol in a public place. Yeah. Her backyard is not a public place. So the alcohol violation wouldn't fly, but the criminal trespass would.
So maybe you could post a sign, and from what I hear, you need to probably post a sign, and that's unfortunate. But
no. Or just tell them, correct?
There is a sign next door, and they walk right over her lawn, too. And they ignore the private property signs. Yeah. They do with the condos as well. Yeah. They just ignore them and use our backyards to
get
down.
That's the neighborhood where I live, and I hear a lot of input from the people at the condos, and, you know, and you know, you're right. I just want to stress the point, though. It doesn't, you know, everybody pays taxes. Like you mentioned that these business people don't pay taxes. The people that own the property pay taxes. In fact, they're standing here.
I just want to make a comment. I actually live in Hampton, so I do pay taxes.
It doesn't matter. Everybody,
I'm paying quite a high view tax where I am.
Okay, it doesn't matter how much people pay for their taxes.
It
doesn't,
but we're not getting anything for the taxes that we pay.
Okay,
and we have parking. They park both sides of the road, all the way up in front of our homes.
Yep.
And the sign, the resident parking is not, I know you don't want to hear it. The resident parking isn't going to solve it, because if we all have a sticker resident parking, you've heard all of these surfers that live in Hampton, they're going to be parking there. So there needs to be something different done.
Thank you for your comments. Yeah. Would somebody else like to speak?
Hi, Angela Stevens, Ray Hamill, 867 Ocean Boulevard. We've actually been very lucky. We have very good luck with the surfers. We find them incredibly respectful. They, you know, like they said, I think they see themselves as stewards of the ocean for the most part. And we would like to thank the police force as well. We have been, we've had nothing but excellent experiences. With that said, right across the street from us, we have a group of trucks that gathers every single night. And they all have big pipes, and they're proud of it. And every single night, without fail, spring and fall, not summer because there's no room, right?
The sliding glass doors are gone.
And so
I'm aware of them very much.
Not only do they do their pipes, but every car that drives by or motorcycle or anything that looks like it could potentially have more than a four-cylinder, they kind of do this and encourage them to rev it, right? So we're up all night with that. It is maybe very specific to our kind of our house and maybe the houses next to us, but it is ridiculous.
Where do you live again?
867 Ocean, corner 15th.
Yeah.
So we have, I've not let him go outside. We have called the police a few times, and I don't think they're bad kids, right? They're just having fun.
Yeah.
They're enjoying themselves, but it is ridiculous. And if there is a noise ordinance, which I'm hearing there is, and I apologize to the gentleman who hates signs, we want a sign. I'll pay for it. Anything you
want to
add?
Yeah, I will say this about the police. It's great that they come. You can't. I grew up in Lowell.
when the cops come next year, they get out of the car and they look around, see what kind of booze you got, pot, whatever you have. They just talk from the window. That's bullshit.
Okay. All right. This is why I don't let him out of the house.
One question that I have is, like, there are certain areas where people park semi-tractor trailers and leave them there overnight. And that's allowed, from what I understand, because I've complained about it in the past. So is there anything that can be done about that? There's trailers, you know, semi-tractor trailers park along the wall there at the south end of the cement wall.
That is, again, the jurisdiction of the state park, who has their own parking enforcement. The town of Hampton has no parking authority in the state park. So that would have to be something that would be addressed through DRED. Now, if they would request us to move those people along through some type of, I know we've talked about memorandums of understanding, that they would grant that authority, maybe. But as we sit here today, no. That would be something that would have to be handled by a state park employee that was designated with that authority.
Thank you. Please, someone join us at the podium. I think we're bringing out these.
You get one more here.
I just don't want anybody to get the wrong idea. I think the surfers are very good. They park out in front of my house, the only problem I have, and now they're going to educate them. They are very polite. They have never thrown anything on my lawn, and I've been here a long time. I have nothing against them except, and I'd probably do the thing, they're trying to sneak a car in and it's sticking out on the beach road. Other than that, they're very respectful. I think I had one that gave me a hard time all this time. Thank you.
Okay, someone else, please join us at the podium. There's a lot of people here. Now's your time to speak.
Good evening. My name is Bill Driscoll. I'm a Hampton resident. I was a summer resident as of 1980, and upon my retirement in 2005, I raised my home and moved down here full time. And I too enjoy Hampton, but oftentimes I feel as though there are certain infringements upon me that are perpetrated by people who come to the neighborhood, much as Joyce just stated. And Joyce wasn't generalizing and saying that all surfers are bad. I know what she sees. I've seen it myself. They park in front of her home. They walk across her lot and the lot of the woman next door who was elderly. They have posted signs that say, please keep off the property. And she has requested that they stay off the property, has stood there, and I have seen them walk past her. Is that an indictment of the entire fraternity? It certainly isn't. I think she's just speaking to specific instances. My complaint relative to what is happening up on Boar's Head is people coming looking for parking, and once again, probably not being able to find free parking on the boulevard. Yeah. They drive up onto Boar's Head. I came from a wedding one day, returned at about 7 o'clock at night, and there was a car in my driveway. And I waited a little while. I sat on the front porch with two neighbors, and finally these people walked along, and I said, what were you doing parking here? They said, oh, we didn't realize that somebody lived here. Your blinds were drawn. And I listened to it, and I said nothing. I have many neighbors because I do have some room in my driveway, and invariably they will inquire of me if they have guests who wish to park. And invariably my answer is the same. It's in the affirmative, of course. But I have had people pull up on my grass. I dare not call it a lawn. Pull right up onto my grass and right in my yard. And I walk out and say, gee whiskers, you can't park there. And they look at me and they have said, quote, and this is in more than one occasion, well, where do you expect us to park? Yeah. And I'm telling you, that is not one of those things that just happens It's not a rare occurrence. It happens often. So I'm not here to say that, look, everyone is bad, that the surfers are driving us crazy, but they are driving some people on Boar's Head crazy. And I have seen them hopping the fence across the street from me and then hopping the other fence to get down to the ocean side and then getting stuck on the way back and not being able to do it again because the people are sitting in the yard and they can't do it. So all and I think I don't know. You know, this is your bailiwick deciding what you think you should do, and I don't have the wisdom to know what you should all do. But I think that resident parking is something to concern yourselves with. I think it's a swell idea. It has worked up in Wells, Maine. I have property in Seabrook Beach, and it has worked well in Seabrook Beach. As a matter of fact, I can't begin to tell you how well I think it has worked in Seabrook Beach. So I appreciate the opportunity to come here, and it's a personal catharsis, something that's been in me for years. So thank you very much for having all of us, and I'm sure we can reach some sort of rational decisions here. But I just hope you would consider the parking, resident parking. I think it's a good idea. I know it has worked elsewhere. Thank you very much for the opportunity.
Now, Chief, do you want to let people know what they need to do if someone's parked in their on their property?
They can simply call the police department. We'll respond, and they can go ahead and order a record themselves, because once it's on your property, you have the right to have it removed.
So you don't have to have police permission to call a wrecker?
You do not need to have police permission, but I would recommend you call us, because invariably those things become hostile when they show back up and their cars are
okay, great.
Wrecker
Thank
on the
you.
Way. So,
please join us.
Tom Teresi, 781 Ocean Boulevard. I understand the dilemma you have. You have businesses to consider. You have people who are summer residents, who have guests. But you do... I ask you please to consider quality of life for people who live here year-round, because it's critical. I mean, we're not looking to... Taxes isn't the issue. The issue is quality of life. On Saturday and Sunday morning in the summertime, the first three spaces that are gone, on 6th Street, not Ocean Boulevard, 6th Street, sometimes I can't back out of my driveway to go play golf. Okay? I mean, it's just crazy. And... They're there. They're not bad people, but they're there to avoid paying $2. Yeah. And that $2 is impacting our lives. So just please consider the quality of life issue. Thank you.
Thank you. Mrs. Teresi, did you have any? No. Anybody else? Please come up to the podium. Barbara, you're someone that's lived there for many years. No? Anybody else going to have something to say, a point that hasn't been met? Or just repeat the same one? We're all ears tonight.
Yes, I could. Can I just say?
No. Just come on up, please.
No, it's just a good thing. I did live.
You have to say your name and... your name and address.
My name is Barbara McCafferty, and I live on Kings Highway. I did live at 90-92 Kings Highway, right at the bottom of 10th Street. And, yes, the surfers used to come down and park in front of my house, because there's quite a bit of parking there. What used to annoy me is somebody would park right in the middle, and then it would not leave space enough for maybe two or three other cars. And I'd ask them, pull up, just so other cars, because they'll park so they do block the driveways with the with their bumpers in the front. But I've never had a problem. Never.
With the surfers?
Never, yeah. I never did with being fresh or rude. I was, when I first moved there, I was a little surprised that they would dress right in front of me or undress in front of me. They open up the car door and think they're hiding. But I get used to that too after a while.
Catch you out the window, probably. The thing is, you still live right where you used to live?
No, I don't. I don't live in that house, but I lived further down. But I live in a condo now, so I don't really have that parking and issue.
And were you pretty close to the pump station?
No, just right at the bottom of 10th Street. Yeah, between 9th and 10th.
Okay.
Yeah, I know what some of the residents, I have a friend that lives down there too, and She has had some problems. She has.
Is there somebody that lives near the pump station that would like to come? I just heard someone say.
Yeah, because she's. Oh, there's some.
Well, I already spoke, but I concur with Greg's letter that he sent you, because I'm right on 12th Street, and that's from here to the restroom away from my house. They're talking about the old pump station. So I concur with whatever Greg said in that letter, and it is true.
And interesting enough, I talked to a lady today that lived there also in those condos that are right to the north of the pump station. Mm-hmm. And she said that these issues really didn't exist 10 years ago. They've sort of come on. Do you concur with that? If this is more of a recent type thing?
Yeah, I've been there for 15 years, and I've seen it escalate mm-hmm. through the years.
So it's escalating.
It is. Mm-hmm. It is. And that's another dog park there, too. People walk the dogs in there. They don't pick up the dog feces either. You know, that place is a germ pack, I guess. I don't know what else you would call it. But yeah, that's a true story.
Thank you. Anyone else out there would like to comment? Please, now is the time. Seeing none, we're going to close the public hearing and bring it back.
You want to go around once for the selectmen to say something?
Well, after we do, we're going to go around.
You need a time to close it. Who's got the right time?
Clock is not right.
Oh, it's not right.
Somebody's got to watch.
8:10.
8:10, closing the public hearing.
Okay.
I'd just like to thank the people that came out today.
We appreciate it.
We appreciate it all. I appreciate Dave Cropper and Ralph Fatillo. For trying to put that into their blogs and stuff. I think that will help. But I think we all have to do it. We got some tough decisions to make here. But I want to be thankful for everybody that came out and spoke, those that sent letters. You've done a very good job at letting us know. We have some decisions to make. I think we all know that area very well. I personally grew up in that neighborhood. I lived there from 66 to 2001 or 2002. Now I just live on the other side of town, but I grew up down there. My family had a business down there for 50 or 60 years, so I know North Beach pretty well. But I want to thank you all for coming down. And
and anyone that wants to stay and listen for a few minutes, because we are going to talk here within the board.
So,
Mr. Bridle?
That's it. Thank you.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Can we close the doors?
I'll take care of that.
Well, then say something.
Mrs. Woolsey?
Yes.
Please.
Yes.
As soon as everyone goes outside, please close the door.
Oh, got it.
Mrs. Woolsey, you have the floor. No talking inside, please. Mrs. Woolsey?
I think what it boils down to is a matter of respect. All of us live in town. We live in different areas of town. And I don't have to put up with the problems that a lot of these people have outlined, both in their emails and here tonight in person. I think we should all be respected. I think we all are owed a quality of life. I may pick up one or two beer cans in front of my house over the summer, but that's a lot different from the circumstances that some of these people have to put up with. And I think it's up to us to try to protect the quality of life of every resident who lives here or who pays taxes here, and also to protect the public interest by watching out for parking problems and emergency access for emergency vehicles. So I think that something certainly needs to be done, and I'm looking forward to working on it.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Kudos for an excellent meeting. Well conducted, Mr. Welch, getting out the word. And to the folks that spoke tonight, and it is Hampton Beach, and people like to come here. And you folks are remarkable stewards of that that property right, your deeded property rights down there. And there was some excellent commentary. And Winnicott Road is no different at many times of the day with fire stations, with 7,000 or 8,000 cars a day coming up and down this road right here, with school. So we all sacrifice to live in this great community, and I think it's working relatively well. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Waddell.
Thank you. Thank people for coming out, and I think there's a lot of good comments made tonight. I think Sheila made some good comments, surprisingly. No.
You'll pay for that one now.
about you know, whether we really, we have to be careful, and we have to watch out what we do and how we approach this and how we find the final solution we come up to. I think everybody's rights have to be respected. I think the rights of the taxpayers, the rights of the people that live here, I think the rights of the business owners have to be protected. You know, they're doing a service for Hampton here. I think surfers also, I think, you know, people coming to the beach. It's a beach. It's in the ocean front. It's open to everybody. It's not closed to Hampton residents. You know, we don't live in Connecticut or a place like that where they close all their beaches and everything to everybody. You know, it's open to the people, so we have to be careful of that. I moved here myself 8 years ago, moved to the beach. I live in a condo right at the end of High Street, and I accepted the fact that in the winter it was going to be really quiet and nice, and in the summer it was going to be really noisy and kind of interesting to watch people. You know, motorcycles drive me insane. The loud things drive me insane. I can tell you for sure, when I was in the State House, I tried to co-sponsor a bill to cut down the noise on the motorcycles, and the amount of people that came in against that was phenomenal. Phenomenal. So that's a difficult situation. It's difficult for the police to handle, but I'm sure they would. And I'm sure if somebody's having a problem in their yard or something, that you really should call the police. And you really should tell them, hey, listen, the guy's trespassing my house. I need some help. And if the police don't respond, which I believe they will, if they don't, get in touch with the town manager. But thanks, everybody, for coming, and good comments.
I would like to ask, now, 3 years ago, we had, when this issue was being discussed and we changed, went back to change how the parking was on, I believe, on High Street. Didn't we change it?
It was High Street. We made a change that was not received well, and there was some changes that we went back to, and we also had a work crew come in the county jails to push back the Phragmites, mm-hmm. so that the cars could actually fit in off of the pavement. That was the big problem. Is she continued eastbound when people were trying to park in those areas because of the overgrowth of the Phragmites? It was pushing them out onto the roadway, which you can't park on the pavement in that area. Once we cut that back, it opened up a few more spots, and I think we kind of met that middle ground with most people about controlling the parking without encroaching into the travel portion of the roadway.
Have you seen any problems with how the changes went that we did then?
On High Street, I think it's a different...
And in the parking lot?
I think it's a different issue that we're looking at. At least my number one priority that I'm concerned about is the access for emergency vehicles, particularly ambulances and fire engines, getting up and down those numbered streets. Right now, I think it's 17th, 18th, and 19th Street have fire lanes, so it's one side parking on those three streets. I believe what my recommendation would be is the rest of the numbered streets from Winnicott Road moving up to 16th Street should also go to one sided parking, similar to what we have down at the Main Beach, simply because the ability to get up and down those roads, they're narrowing. It's just, if you have two cars parked on opposite sides in the same area, you cannot get an ambulance through there. It won't happen.
And obviously, our number one priority is safety, but do you think that there would be an advantage to having things, because we're going to talk next week at the other end, but would there be an advantage to things to be very similar on both ends?
I'm sorry.
You know, should there be... like a basic policy, like being parking on one side of the street, should it be in more, you know, in both areas?
I think we have to look at that street by street, depending on the width of the street. I mean, it really comes down to that.
So,
but if you look at, you know, if you look at the leaded streets, it was pretty obvious with all the new curbs and sidewalks that we put in, which helps with the pedestrian issues, and then the parking issues. Because if you remember, we had similar problems on the Main Beach. People were parking everywhere, and, you know, is this private property? Is this town property? And, you know, you're having that argument and you're risking public safety because it was the same thing down on some of those more narrow streets. Mm. Now, with the one-sided parking, it's pretty easy for the officers to go down and enforce because it's clearly delineated where you can park. So when you park somewhere you're not supposed to, you stick out like a sore thumb down the Main Beach. As you move up to the North Shore, that becomes, especially those numbered streets, that becomes harder to discern what's... You know, the gentleman say that his property line extends out into the roadway. Well, There's also right-of-ways that we have to be concerned with, and we have to be, if it's a paved road, we have to be able to get fire engines, we have to be able to get ambulances and police vehicles down there. It's a must.
And what do you think that you could do? Is there a way to mark the signage at that pump station, like no trespassing or...
I think if you look around the other pump stations in town, the one on Winnicott Road and I believe on High Street, they have signage to that effect, no parking, and similar to the parking we have down at the safety pier down on the harbor. We could post it, just be realistic. People are going to violate the postings. It's when we catch them doing it, we have to take affirmative action. We find people parked, believe it or not, in that drive area, the parking area for the safety pier. And we ticket and have had to tow cars out of there because we have to have access to that. Mm-hmm. Same thing with the pumps, the pump stations. We'll get calls from Public Works occasionally. People will park in there and walk down to the beach for the day. So we have to tow those.
Yeah. So at that particular pump station,
we would if cars. If we posted it similarly. And I'm sorry, I didn't have a chance to look at what postings are down there now. I'll take a ride by tomorrow. And check that out. But if they're properly posted and we have people on there in violation of the posting, we'll tow the cars. Mm.
So what is that pump station? Is it working at full capacity there?
That pump station is offline. It's not connected to anything currently. When the sewer line was replaced on Kings Highway, that pump station was no longer needed. We are looking at using that pump station for the drainage situation on Kings Highway.
Ah.
So that we don't have to reinvent the wheel and dig the entire roadway up in order to have half it already done. The pump station is the only pump station in town that does not have a chain link fence around it and postings on the property.
Oh.
So what is your opinion about posting something to keep people from going into the woods?
Well, of course, they can walk around the pump station. That's exactly what's happening. They're also walking around the house next door and going to the bathroom behind the house.
Wonderful.
And we've had complaints with regards to that. So that's a property owner issue, and I understand that young lady is just not here most of the time, and she needs to have some affirmative action taken, and we'll talk to her about that. As far as walking around behind the pump station in the woods and relieving yourself, that's private property as well. We don't have any jurisdiction there, but the owner of that property should be informed as to what's going on, and they should probably post the property and call the police if somebody's seen them.
So somebody else owns that woods?
Yes. Yeah, we don't own the woods.
Okay, great. That's what my point. Thank you. Any other comments from the board?
No. Set.
So.
I apologize to Sheila.
Thank you all for coming tonight. We appreciate it.
May get a vote back.
May not.
Here you go, Sheila.
Are we going to take this up, Mr. Chairman, and work on it for a resolution, or wait for the chief?
We're going to wait till we hear from the comments next week, and then I'm sure we'll...
I'll put the department heads together and have them review it, come back with something for
Excellent.
The board to consider.
Excellent.
If people could please hurry, because we have another hearing that we need to have here this evening. We appreciate that everybody came.
That was a good turnout.
Yeah, it was.
I was surprised there wasn't anyone here from your condo.
There was. They didn't say anything.
That's because you're scared, though.
They relied upon their representative. It's a good thing.
It's on the town email. Everybody's phone number is on the town website. Everybody's websites are there. And you can always send something to Mr. Welch, and it'll be sent out to all, everyone.
Yeah.
If you address something to him, he will make a copy and send it to everyone.
Right.
Thank you so much for coming tonight and talking.
All right. Approval of minutes, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, wait a minute. Where is that?
I'll move that we approve the minutes of April 6th.
I'll second.
All those in favor? First of all, we haven't had announcements in community calendar.
True. Mm-hmm.
So we're moving back to that.
Okay.
Mr. Bridle.
I don't have anything. Thank you.
Mrs. Woolsey?
No.
Mr. Bean?
Nothing.
Now you had something. Now I can't remember what it was. We're all at talk. But I'll think of it.
Okay. Move the minutes of April 7, 2015.
Second.
All those in favor?
There. Took care of that.
The town manager's report. Mr. Welch.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board. So everybody knows the filing period for tax exemptions for your property taxes for 2015 filings has closed. It closes April 15th. The Public Works Department continues, believe it or not, to move snow in our municipal parking lots. And I did examine them this afternoon and this evening as I was traveling about town. And all the municipal parking lots are clear for regular use at this point. We did have to make them ready for the summer weather periods. And we just want people to remember that if you're parking in the municipal lots of the beach and do not have a paid parking permit, you are subject to tickets and fines. Good. And towing.
Good.
The Public Works Department has informed me that the bids for the work on the High Street Lafayette Road drainage are scheduled for return on April 30th. They had a pre-bid meeting in here today, and the bids for spring paving are due on April 24th. Mm-hmm. That includes Exeter Road and the three small streets adjoining Exeter Road. The capital improvements program report is in progress for 2016 to 2021, and we expect to have the report in the selectmen's hands for review and approval by mid-May. The Property Liability Trust has notified us that with the exception of filed claims, they will be going out of business effective June 30th, 2016. The town will be going out to bid for property liability, workers' compensation, unemployment compensation coverages sometime after July 1 of this year, so we can have those figures for our next budget. There are a number of other things. We had a great meeting with the North Beach. We have a meeting next week dealing with the South Beach, the West Side streets, and the area off of White's Island. We've had a number of complaints regarding why we're bothering to patch Exeter Road.
Yes.
I can tell you that we're bothering to patch Exeter Road because people keep on complaining about it. As long as folks complain about it, we have to fix it. So we're doing it because we're doing what we need to do. Other than that, that's about it for the week, Mr. Chairman.
Questions for the town manager, Mr. Bridle.
All set, thank you.
Mrs. Wolseley.
Yeah, Fred, I thought the bid for the Exeter Road project was due in on the 17th. Is that
no? It's
now
the
30th. You said it's the 30th. Okay.
It's the other projects that do the 17th.
Okay, and we want to do that as soon as possible once those bids are in.
We do, and we've already told the bidders that we'd like to have it done by mid-May.
Because everybody's going crazy, and I can't tell you how many calls on patching on the Exeter Road. Yep. Okay, thank you.
Nothing, Mr. Wardell?
No.
Okay, and thank you for your report, Fred.
Thank you,
Mr.
Chairman.
I appreciate it. New business, Mr. Bridle?
Nothing.
Mrs. Wolseley?
Yeah, really quickly, at some point in time, I want to see us go back to a discussion with Ed Tinker on continuing to set up leases for the oceanfront property.
Mr. Bean? Mr. Waddell?
No, sir.
No, and I don't either.
Just one thing, Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
We had approved today the hiring of the part-time summer person to finish up the measuring list for the public for the assessing department.
Good.
And with the board's permission, I'll circulate that. It needs your approval because you are the assessors. The assessor, your hired assessor, has approved it. It has gone through the assistant town manager's office and been reviewed, and all the official paperwork has been signed.
I will so move that we approve the part-time person for the revale work.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. And now we're going to the discussion about Stowcroft, the end of Stowcroft.
Did you get the old business, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Okay. My only concern with old business is you still have one committee appointment that you need to decide on, which is the recycling committee.
Can we put that on the agenda for next week?
I certainly can do that.
I was going to suggest that.
Very good. It is so done.
Thank you. Mr. Gerald.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, with regard to the Stowcroft Drive extension, the board has had in front of it for some time two petitions, one from Attorney Kalman representing the Graves Trust seeking to have the board lay out a town road over Lot B, so-called, showed up on a 1983 subdivision of Stowcroft. The other competing petition is a petition by Attorney Derek Durbin representing some abutters in which he seeks to have the selectmen terminate any public servitude that may have arisen as a result of the 1983 subdivision, that is, any dedication to public use of Lot B. The board has heard all the parties and all the attorneys orally on February 23rd. There have been two follow-up deadlines for written briefings answering the board's questions, the first of which was March 20, 2015, and the second was April 1, 2015. The board today took the required view of the premises. Whenever someone seeks to have a road laid out over a given property, it's the obligation of the board by law to view those premises, which the board did today in public. I would recommend now that the board proceed to deliberations on the two subjects. If the board would like, I can outline for the board the law in question on whether or not there is an occasion to lay out, if the board would like.
Okay, we'd like you to go ahead with that, please.
Thank you. One of the recent cases passed by the New Hampshire Supreme Court called Green Crow Corporation versus Town of New Ipswich, a 2008 case, outlined a two-step process for determining whether an occasion exists. The first step is to balance the public interest in the layout against the rights of the affected landowner, namely the landowner, whoever that may be, of Lot B. If the rights of the affected landowner outweigh the public interest in the layout is not justified and there is no occasion for it. If, however, the public interest justifies the taking of the land without the owner's consent, the second step is to balance the public interest in the layout against the burden it imposes upon the town. If the balancing required by the second step favors the public interest, occasion for the layout exists. In that Green Crow Corporation case, the court noted that in past cases, the analysis of whether there was a public interest for a layout included examining whether the proposed roadway would be easily integrated with the existing road system. Number two, ease existing traffic flow. Number three, improve convenience of travel. Number four, facilitate transportation for existing school children. Five, improve accessibility to business district and employment centers. Six, improve accessibility for fire, emergency, and police services. And seven, benefit significant portions versus a small fraction of the town's tax base or year-round residents. The board has been shown during the course of your proceedings not only the plan on which Lot B appears, but also on the February 23rd hearing, a schematic for the proposed 13-lot subdivision that would necessarily be fed by the laying out of a road over Lot B and the road, the town road that would be created as a result. So in analyzing the burden upon the town, the court and the Green Crow case indicated that this board would not be appropriate to act as a planning board and considering planning considerations, but nevertheless has an ability to talk about the public burden of the road itself. So with that in mind, I would recommend that before deliberating that the board hear from Mr. Welch regarding the burden as to the road.
Mr. Welch?
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I did have the Department of Public Works challenge to, in fact, determine what those costs are. And we've divided it into several categories, refuse and recycling collection, sewer services, catch basin cleaning, snow removal, fire hydrants, street lights, and pavement resurfacing and pavement management. As far as refuse and recycling is concerned, there will be 13 residences. We will be required to collect trash from all 13 residences. Trash per year would amount to 20,280 pounds. That cost to the town would be $883.80. For the first year, disposal of refuse costs for the carts that need to be there is $58.50 on the average. The cost for disposal of recycling is $13,520 pounds and a cost of $477.73 per year, and the carts another $58.50. Excuse me. The cost to collect refuse and recycling, $619.97. Sewer service. There are 13 residences. They would be connected to the municipal sewer system. A minimum of 26 bedrooms. A total of 949,000 gallons of sewer waste to be treated based upon the state formula. The cost of that would be $2,847 per year. There is also the cost to clean the sewer lines, which is at least once every 4 years, at a cost of $1,950. Then there's the cost to clean all the sewer manholes at least once every 4 years at a cost of $560. There is a cost of catch basin cleaning to comply with federal requirements under the Stormwater Act. There would be 14 catch basins that need to be cleaned. The cost is $80 per basin or $560 minimum. Snow removal. Snow plowing of the roadway in question would take 76 minutes. The number of runs per event would be 3, and the number of events per year would be 10 at a cost of $4,750. That does not include any salting or sanding of the particular roadway in question. Hydrant rental, there are 2 hydrants. The cost to the taxpayers would be $950 per year. There are no street lights. They are all private according to the current plans. Road resurfacing and road maintenance. The surface area is 38,520 square feet or 4,280 square yards. We estimate that the roadway must be overlaid at least once every 10 years. That is to say, it needs to be repaved. So that involves grinding and paving of the surface. And the cost of that is $25,647. The annual cost is $14,396.42. That does not include any work preparatory to opening the roadway under the Lot B, supposedly, if it were a roadway, or the reallocation of the cul-de-sac in front of that, which would be subject to hearings under the current tree statute, posting public hearings and possible appeals to the Superior Court. The elimination of the cul-de-sac, which would require a town meeting approval for discontinuance of a portion of a public way. Thank you.
Thank you. I did want to note that the board was provided at the outset of its proceedings back in February an extensive legal opinion from attorney Peter Laughlin, 12 pages in length, which actually was provided also to the opposing attorneys so that they could examine that and comment on the questions of the board in relation to it in the subsequent briefings that occurred March 20 and April 1. So the letter from attorney Laughlin would be part of the record for the board's consideration. In deliberation, I would just indicate to the board that the RSA chapter involved, RSA 43:4, requires that the board make a decision in writing to be filed with the town clerk, and I would suggest that all the deliberations, the factors that the board mentions in its deliberations and upon which its decision turns, if the board wishes, could be put in writing by my office and presented to the board next week for approval, if you wish.
So we won't be doing the deliberations?
You would. You would do the deliberations tonight, make your, make whatever decision you felt, but in order to back it up in writing, that would be presented next week based on what you decide this week.
Okay. Comments, Mr. Bridle?
I mean, this is one of those strange things that's been kind of left for so long that it's gone with mm-hmm. Who owns the piece of property, where it is owned, what's the status of the street. You listed a number of things in that previous court case, and as I heard you list them off, I couldn't see any of those that would fall into line with what this would do. So I'd like to hear what others have to say, but I mean, that's what I'm leaning towards.
Mrs. Wolseley?
I agree with Rusty, and I'm prepared to make a motion at the conclusion of our discussion.
Mr. Bean?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Esquire, in literature that you provided to us, you specifically talk about the Green Crow case. And specifically under the RSA in this particular case, that it would not be appropriate for the selectman to consider as part of performing its occasion analysis the anticipated impact associated with the development that could result from the upgrade of the land involved to enable the development. The court concluded that the legislature did not intend for a board of selectmen to use its authority to determine occasion for layout or upgrade of a highway under RSA 2:318 as a vehicle for effectively conducting land use planning or zoning, which the court instead felt was the province of the planning board. So this hasn't come to us before until this scenario presented itself. The board has done due diligence in researching this. How applicable is that Green Crow analysis that you did into the vote of the board this evening?
That is the latest case wherein the Supreme Court has spoken on the subject. It also happens to be a case where there was, like this one, a proposal to lead to a development. The layout was going to lead to a previously undeveloped property. So factually, there is some connection. I believe the factors that Mr. Welch has laid out with regard to the road and the burdens that road maintenance would pose is appropriate to consider, in as much as the applicant itself presented this for the board's consideration.
Thank you. Is this project that is described or in this pictorial, is this come before the planning board?
It has initially, and there were some questions about the wetness or not of the property, and one of the steps that was taken was the developer withdrew the application as a subdivision and asked the planning board to go forward on a design review basis while other issues were being addressed, one of which is this one having to do with the layout or not of a road over lot B.
Thank you. And in the initial planning board notes for the initial plan, when it talks about that lot B will provide access to abutting properties, does that encumber the board to vote in the affirmative for determining an occasion to approve this evening?
The extensive opinion that Attorney Laughlin has given you, with which I agree, would indicate that just because access was discussed to the adjacent parcel, in this case the Graves parcel, is not the equivalent of a layout, a promise to lay out a road.
Right. Thank you, Esquire. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And Mr. Wardell.
Yeah, I've read all this stuff once, twice, three times, and I'm always interested in philosophical questions on whether truth is absolute or not. and I've determined the truth as an absolute, but each attorney has their own absolute truth. So it makes it very difficult. But in reading this, I just get really bogged down on it. You know, you had A, B, and C. A and C were both developed, right? So when Fieldstone was developed, was that did they have to follow the same requirements that we're now requiring for this one? Was that all taken into consideration, or wasn't it? So, you know, did that go along with the 1983 plan that A, B, and C would afford access to the property to those people? And I think that's an important thing to take into consideration. And, you know, are we landlocking a person by not allowing them to have access to their property? And I think that's an important thing to understand. And I think past practices, if we've made mistakes in the past, that's fine. But past practices have to come into it, I believe. And you know, what was the requirements for A and C? And now what are the requirements for B? Are they going to be different? So that's my feeling on it.
I would note that one of the parts of the briefings you received, there was a question about what were the history mm-hmm. of the two developments that were accessed by lots A and lot C. Mm-hmm. Both of those were presented to the planning board within the six-year time that's right. mentioned in lot 3.
But they weren't deeded within that 6 years, were they? Wasn't it after that it was finally taking place?
The developments occurred at a later time.
At a later time. And mm-hmm. is the six-year period. I mean, I'm just looking at this from a legal point of view, and I think sure. we have to watch out for that also. It's the six-year time. Was that written into it? I mean, at one point, the law was that it was forever, right?
Well, actually, this situation is one of the most unique I've ever seen, and I think Attorney Laughlin commented on that as well, in that the six-year period was not a product of the law. It was built into a note. Mm-hmm. That appeared on the plan, that lots A, B, and C are 50-foot strips to be used for future access to abutting properties. These lots are non-buildable lots. Ownership remains in Farina Corporation for a period of 6 years from recording date of these plans, after which ownership goes to the town of Hampton. Farina Corporation retains the right to sell lots A, B, and C during the six-year period to provide access to abutting properties. And so the six...
It can be interpreted. That's the problem. I mean, it's very vague, and it's a problem that a planning board left us from 1983 by not being very specific on what they were talking about. And, you know, so that's where I'm coming from.
I pretty much have the same feeling that you do. But so what... How's your deliberation going?
Well, I'll wait for a motion.
Well, may I be recognized?
You would like to comment again?
Yes. This has never been designated as a road.
It's an interpretation.
Beg pardon?
Go on.
Oh, this has never been designated as a road, and the time frame has run out. I think what I focused on is the fact that we have to understand we have no right to make a decision in behalf of a private property owner that conflicts or may conflict with the interests of the town. Is that a fair statement, or am I not doing that properly?
Well, the tests that the Supreme Court has given us, as difficult as they may be to follow, do dictate that the public interest is to be weighed in the calculation.
Right. In light of that, I will move.
Mr. Chairman, I don't think we're done with this discussion. Oh, yeah. Prior to the 83 plan, was this subject property in the Graves property, was that landlocked?
As we speak, there is a way to access the Graves Trust property over other property owned by the Graves Trust in Northampton.
But from the Hampton side, no. Prior to Stowcroft, was this property landlocked? I think the answer is yes.
I think that's true.
Thank you.
Do we have the t-
town has never been given a deed to that property as it was supposed to have been done 6 years after this.
That's
correct. So it's still owned by Frank Keener Corporation or by the Chamateros or?
Yes.
Okay.
In terms of a what they call record title. There are rights that people have to property that occur even without a deed, so that the various proponents here have said that the town may already have what they call equitable title. In other words, if we went to court and based on the language of this plan said the town owns this lot, a court could say, yes, we do. It also could say the other way.
I have a question on that. If the town doesn't own it, the town's had it on their books as owning it, haven't they, on the tax records?
That the funny thing about tax records is that they're not determinative as to title. That factor might be something that the court would hear, but it's not a determinative factor any more than what the tax maps show in terms of determining boundary lines.
And the other party has not paid any taxes on it, right?
That's correct.
So, okay, I mean, it's just very vague and very fuzzy and had been left up in the air.
It is one of the more unusual situations. Yeah. You couldn't invent this.
No.
Yeah. Mr. Bridle.
One further thing. Is Stowcroft a public street or a private street?
It is a street that is dedicated to public use by virtue of being shown as a road on a plan approved by the planning board. My understanding, and Mr. Welch has looked at many a road since his coming here, is that it has not gone through the formal acceptance process. However, the town, as has been pointed out in some of the briefings, has spent a lot of money in terms of maintenance of roads and has appropriated money for that purpose.
Now, how about the other two roads that are off that? Are they?
Westridge and Fieldstone are also
in that same category?
In that same right. category.
So the whole place is a mess.
Yes.
Well, yeah. The town did attempt to accept Westridge Road.
And what happened?
The notice of acceptance and the notice of posting was defective. It was found out at the public hearing. The selectmen canceled the acceptance and never came back to do it again.
Mm-hmm. Say that again, please.
The Westridge Road was noticed at a public hearing to accept as a town road, as a Class 5 highway. It was discovered at the time of the hearing that the notice was defective because one wasn't given. And for that reason, the acceptance proceeding that was opened that night was canceled. It was not, there was no acceptance made, and the instructions were to come back to a future meeting with the proper documentation to have the road accepted, and that was never done. That goes back to shortly after the road was built.
Mm-hmm. And what year is that?
That goes back into the 80s sometime. I can't remember off the top of my head which year.
Thank you.
So we had the town accept, it's not an accepted road, but we went through the process that we went through with all the other private roads to make sure that they can have their snow plowed.
The town's policy had been, and there was a town meeting article passed, that all roads in town would be plowed, mm-hmm. whether they were town roads or not. Mm-hmm. That was a town meeting vote, all right? That's since been vacated because the Supreme Court said, mm-hmm. in the case dealing with the town of Jaffrey, that you could not expend public money on private property. So what we have done is we have arranged for emergency lane acceptance under the statute, which allows us to plow unaccepted streets and private roads in order to provide fire, police, and ambulance access to those particular properties. We've been doing that right along to almost all of the roads in town. There are some that are maintained on their own, but there are some that we in fact do, and you've held hearings on a number of them here over the years. It was the policy of the town just to simply start plowing it the minute and maintaining it the minute the road was built. That's no longer the policy of the town because it violates the statutory procedures.
Mm-hmm. And the gentleman's name that owns the property is Mr.
Charmataro?
Charmataro.
No, I'm talking about the regular property that's access from North Portland.
Graves.
Mr. Graves.
I couldn't think of it. And how he pays taxes on that property.
He does.
He's been, but the other property that's Mr. Chimancharo's property, there's been no taxes paid on that.
It was put on by the assessor as town property. There are a number of instances over the years that we found where if a plan was executed by the planning board and it said something was to revert to the town or something was going to be town property, that the assessor simply listed it as town property and never taxed it. Mm-hmm. We believe that's the case here. If, in fact, this board finds that it's not town property, then Mr. Chimancharo is going to be assessed for it and taxed for it.
For the last 6 years.
No. You can't go back in time. March 31st passes and the statute of limitations runs out. You can't assess. So it would be this year that he would be taxed for it.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay, Mr. Chairman.
Mrs. Woolsey.
Okay. Now, each tax year is self-contained. First of all, I think that this does not belong as inappropriate in our jurisdiction. This is a matter for the court, and there are too many unknowns here. I hereby move to deny the layout petition filed by the Graves Trust for the reasons to be set forth in a written decision to be prepared for the board by town council for approval at the board's next meeting on April 27, 2015, to reflect the board's discussions tonight.
Is there a second?
It belongs in court, gentlemen. We don't want to stick our nose out and get the town in trouble.
I second the motion.
For discussion, Mr. Bridle.
Like I said, this whole area up there we have a lot of problems with it. This is one way we may need to go to create at least a little bit of part of it being fixed. And obviously this is going to go to court. But I think we also have a bigger issue on dealing with the rest of the stuff that's going on with those streets up there at a later time. So.
Yeah. You're right. We need to look into that.
Mr. Wardell.
I've made my statement. I just think it's fairly clear-cut that it should be laid out.
Mrs. Woolsey?
I made the motion.
Do you have anything else to say?
No, I think
Mr. Bean?
This board needs to stay out of trouble. And
I have nothing more to say, sir.
Okay. All those in favor? Against? So it's a 3-2. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we'll look forward to council's presentation next week. Thank you, Mr. Gerald.
Thank you for coming in tonight, everybody.
Are you prepared to accept the motion to adjourn, or do you have something
else? No, we're
going to
have closing comments, but I was just waiting till.
Oh, okay. Oh, thank you, sir.
You're welcome, ma'am.
Closing comments?
Any closing comments?
I don't have anything. Thank you. We're all set.
I think it was a good meeting tonight on the public hearing. I think it was really good to have people in and listen to what they had to say, and I think that's a real positive. I mean, we did it with the department heads. We've done it with residents now, and I think we're open to listen and open to different points of view.
And does anyone think we should do it differently next week?
No, that was fine.
It worked out fine. I tried to include
everybody well.
And make it inclusive.
Yeah, it was good.
And I think letting everybody have their say, I think, is good.
Oh, yes.
Yep. Did you have any suggestions, Mr. Charles?
No, I think you did very well.
Now, do we have anything else going on tonight?
I don't believe so. Thank you.
Oh, good.
No, not public.
So, thank you.
Remember, Mr. Chairman, practice makes perfect. See? It'll be even better next week.
Okay, great. Does someone want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion. We adjourn.
At what time? The time is important.
8:58.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll second.
All those in favor, unanimous.
Excellent.
Yeah, I just wanted, I wasn't going to, I didn't.